So in today's lecture, we are going to discuss what is a lead compensator and how we can design a lead compensator using Bode plot. We know that any response has two parts. One is the transient part and one is the steady state part. Lead compensators are used to improve the transient behavior. Okay, so we are going to take up how we can improve the transient response specifications by a lead compensator using Bode plots. Okay, so before we begin, so in general, we have seen the Bode plot. That Bode plot consists of mainly two graphs. One is the gain in decibels, dB gain versus frequency in logarithmic scale. Okay, so this is in logarithmic scale and this is the dB gain. Right, there will be a magnitude plot and there will be a phase angle plot. Okay, say some angle, some value I will just draw. Okay, 0 degree. Some representation, right? This frequency region can be divided into three categories. One is the low frequency region. Okay, one is the low frequency region. One is the mid frequency region. Okay, this is the mid frequency region, and then onwards we will be having high frequency region. High frequency region. Okay, so the total frequency range can be divided into three: the low frequency, the mid frequency, and the high frequency region. Okay, so low frequency region. Low frequency region. Okay, the low frequency region will indicate the steady state behavior. Indicates steady state behavior. Steady state behavior. Okay, hence the gain at low frequencies must be as high as possible so that steady state accuracy is improved. Right? Hence, the gain at low frequencies. Hence, the gain at low frequency should be large enough. Should be large enough to give a high value for error constants. Error constants, and hence to have good steady state accuracy. Okay, so in low frequency region, we prefer to have a large gain as possible so that the steady state error constants are high and hence the steady state error is low. What is steady state error? Steady state error means the error as time tends to infinity. Okay, if you recall, what was steady state error 1 due to a step input? It was 1 divided by 1 plus kp. What was steady state error 2 due to a velocity input or a ramp input? It was 1 by kv. And what was the steady state error when the input was a parabolic input or acceleration input? It was k1 by ka, where kp was what? Limit s tends to 0, gshs. What was kv? Limit s tends to 0, s into gshs. And ka was limit s tends to 0, s square. GSHS. Okay, so steady state error ESS is inversely proportional to the error constants KP, KV, and KA. Okay, so we always prefer to have a large values of these error constants KP, KV, KV, and KA so that the steady state error is as small as possible. Okay, so that is all about the low frequency region. Now we will take about the mid frequency region or the medium frequency region. Medium frequency or mid frequency region. Okay, So media frequency or mid frequency means that range about the gain cross of frequency and phase cross of frequency. What is gain cross of frequency? Frequency at which phase angle becomes gain cross of frequency means frequency at which the magnitude becomes equal to 1 or 0 dB. Okay, so in and around this thing, let's say this is minus 1 degree line, so this will be somewhere here, right? So the region around the omega GC, the gain cross of frequency, and omega PC, the phase cross of frequency, is what is called the mid frequency region or the medium frequency region. It means around omega GC, the gain cross of frequency, and omega PC, the phase cross of frequency. Important. Okay, this is the mid frequency, medium frequency region or mid frequency region. Okay, so this region indicates relative stability and transient behavior. Okay, so as I said in the beginning, the transient response and steady state response constitute the total response, right? So if you want to improve the transient performance, then you have to concentrate on the mid frequency region, where we have the gain cross of frequency and phase cross of frequency. Okay, keep in mind, gain margin and phase margin are the figures of merit for which determine the stability, the relative stability of a system. Okay, and not only that, they will also give an idea about the transient behavior, right? So we have to concentrate on the mid frequency region, or we have to design the compensator so that the mid frequency region is shaped properly to have the desired transient performance. Okay, so low frequency will determine the steady state accuracy. Mid frequency region will give an idea about that transient behavior and relative stability. Okay. So at medium frequency range or at medium frequency range, gain margin and phase margin must be large. Okay, preferably. Okay, then it will be having better relative stability and improved transient behavior. Fine. Now, what next? High frequency region. High frequency region indicates complexity. Okay, and keep in mind, in high frequency means what? Our system can get corrupted by noise. What is noise? Unwanted high frequency signals. Okay, so if you operate in high frequency region, there are more chances that your system performance gets corrupted by noise signals which are of high frequencies. Okay, so we always prefer to have a gain for the system as low as possible so that the system is immune to the noise presence. Okay, so in low frequency region, we want to have a gain as high as possible to improve the steady state behavior. Mid frequency region, we prefer to have a gain margin and phase margin as high as possible so that the transient part is as desired. And in high frequency region, we prefer to have the gain as small as possible so that the noise effects are not prominent. Okay, so this indicates complexity. Okay, right? And at high frequencies, the gain must be attenuated. As rapidly as possible. To minimize noise effects and to have good robustness against model uncertainties. Okay, so in the low frequency region, we prefer to have a gain as high as possible. Mid frequency region, we prefer to have a high gain margin and phase margin so that transient behavior can be shaped. And in high frequency region, we prefer to have a gain as small as possible so that the noise effects can be discarded. Okay, or the noise will not be effective on the system, right? So it is obvious. So what's the purpose of a lead compensator? The purpose of a lead compensator is to improve the transient behavior. Okay, so that means it should change the phase margin path. Okay, so let us get into the details of lead compensator. Lead compensator. Okay, so here the basic idea is to provide a phase boost. The basic idea is to provide a phase boost at gain crossover frequency omega GC. Okay, so what's our purpose? Our purpose is to just give a phase boost at a gain crossover frequency, right? But keep in mind, gain crossover frequency determines what? The phase margin. And phase margin in turn will decide the transient behavior. Okay, why? Because you see, what was phase margin? If you remember, the phase margin expression was tan inverse 2 theta divided by root of minus 2 theta square plus root of 1 plus 4 theta raised to 4. Okay, so if phase margin changes, what happens? The damping ratio theta changes, and hence the transient behavior changes. Okay, so by adjusting the phase margin to a suitable value, we can have the desired transient behavior. Okay, so the purpose of a lead compensator is to simply provide a phase boost at about the gain crossover frequency. Keep in mind, the magnitude, the gain at the low frequency should not be changed. Otherwise, what happens? The steady state error will get affected. Okay, so without disturbing the steady state behavior, we have to reshape the transient behavior, and a lead compensator will help us in that. Okay, so it will provide a phase boost at gain crossover frequency. Fine, then it will also extend the bandwidth. Also extends the bandwidth while providing phase boost. While providing the phase boost. What is bandwidth? Bandwidth is given by this expression. Okay, omega n into root of 1 minus 2 theta square plus root of 4 theta raised to 4 minus 4 theta square plus 2. We had discussed all these things in previous lectures. Okay, so it will also extend the bandwidth. What is bandwidth? The 3 dB gain, 3 dB frequency below the 0 dB value. Okay, that point is what is called the bandwidth frequency, right? So in addition to giving a phase boost at gain crossover frequency, lead compensator will also extend the bandwidth. You'll see that at the end, how it does this. Okay, so coming to lead compensator, what's the transfer function? What will be the Poisson map of a lead compensator? Sigma G omega, okay. So which one will be closer to the origin, the compensator pole or the compensator zero for a lead compensator? Tell me, for a lead compensator, which element will be closer, the zero or the pole? It will be the zero. And to the right, to the left side of zero, we have compensator pole. Is it not? Why? Because if you take a sample point here, the net angle extended at point A will be positive. Okay, this is theta one. And this is minus theta 2. So the net angle will be theta 1 minus theta 2, which is greater than 0. That means a lead compensator will always give a positive phase angle or a leading phase angle. Okay? A lead compensator will always extend a positive angle or a leading angle, phase angle. Okay? That's why it is called lead compensator. Right? So what's the transfer function? I can write like this. GC of S as S plus ZC divided by S plus BC. Okay, what is ZC? ZC is the compensator zero. What is PC? PC is the commutator pole, right? Or I can also express in this form, S plus 1 by alpha t divided by S plus 1 by t. Okay, where I will define alpha as PC by ZC. Get to that one, and ZC as 1 by alpha t and PC as 1 by t. Okay, so you see, always the commutator pole should be to the left side of the commutator zero. That means numerically, PC must be greater than ZC. Okay, so that ratio of the commutator pole to commutator zero will be always greater than 1. So I will call that as alpha. Fine. And I will call the commutator pole as 1 by t. So if you do a little bit manipulation, you will see that the commutator zero will be nothing but 1 by alpha t. Why 1 by alpha t means what? 1 by alpha is what? ZC by PC into 1 by t means PC. Okay, so PC and PC gets cancelled. ZC will be equal to 1 by alpha t. Okay, so this is correct. Right. Now, what is GC of j omega? GC of j omega will be j omega plus ZC divided by j omega plus PC. Or from here, you will get j omega plus 1 by t divided by j omega plus 1 by alpha t. Okay, I forgot to tell you, in different books, this lead commutator has been modeled in different ways. Okay, so you should stick on to any one convention and don't get confused. Fine. In different books, some books they will take this as S plus 1 by t divided by S plus 1 by alpha t. Okay, that's nothing to worry. Just clearly understand the concept. Okay. So I have taken alpha as the ratio of commutator pole to commutator zero. Okay. And in the case of a lead commutator, alpha will be always greater than 1 if you are defining alpha in this way. Okay. Now, what happens if omega is equal to 0? That means the DC gain. If omega is equal to 0, what will you get? This omega becomes zero, you will get ZC by PC, which is non-unity. Okay, and any control system should have preferably a unity DC gain, right? So from here, you will get the unity DC gain, the DC gain as ZC by PC. And from here, you will get the gain as what? 1 by alpha. Okay, so if you want to have unity gain, unity DC gain compensator, then what we have to do? So we can say that right now, the lead compensator by itself introduces a gain of 1 by alpha. Okay. So in most of the cases, that may not be desirable. Why? Because as I said before, the DC gain is not unity. Okay. So if it is undesirable, then it can be eliminated by a suitable amplifier with a gain of alpha. Okay. If not desired, it can be eliminated. By a suitable amplifier. With gain alpha. Okay. So this amplifier gain alpha will cancel this alpha. And you will get a unity DC gain compensator. Okay. Thus, for a unity zero frequency gain means what? The DC gain, or I can write DC gain, lead compensator what should be a transfer function? GC of S must be what? PC by ZC into S plus ZC divided by S plus PC. Okay. Or that will be nothing but alpha times S plus 1 by alpha T whole divided by S plus 1 by T. Okay. So that if you take the DC gain here, when s is equal to 0, PC gets cancelled, SC gets cancelled. Okay, so now you can check when. So what will be your GC j omega now? GC of j omega will be PC by ZC into j omega plus ZC by j omega plus PC, or that will be nothing but alpha times j omega plus 1 by alpha g divided by j omega plus 1 by t. Okay, so if omega equal to 0, you will get your GC of 0 as what? Equal to 1. Fine. So in this way, you can have a DC gain of 1 for a lead compensator. Right? So assume that it is 1. Right? We are not bothered about other thing. Okay, so we will consider only about this transfer function. Okay, alpha into j omega plus 1 by alpha omega t. Right? So coming back, what is GC of S? GC of S is 1 plus. So I will just consider this part, okay? This part, right? So I can write like this. GC of S is equal to 1 plus j omega alpha t divided by 1 plus j omega t. Okay? 1 plus j omega alpha t divided by 1 plus j omega t. Okay. So what's the magnitude? Root of 1 plus omega square alpha square t square divided by root of 1 plus omega square t square. What is the net angle? Net angle will be tan inverse omega alpha t minus tan inverse omega t. Okay. So keep in mind, body plot consists of two graphs. One is the dB gain versus log omega, and phase angle versus log omega. Okay. So we have to find the dB gain as well as the phase angle plot. So what's the magnitude now? Mode. So this is GC of j omega. Correction here. So what is GC of j omega magnitude? That is nothing but root of 1 plus alpha square omega square t square divided by root of 1 plus omega square t square in absolute scale. Or in decibels, what will you get? 20 log what? Root of 1 plus alpha square omega square t square divided by root of 1 plus omega square t square decibels. Okay, so now you can see that there are two corner frequencies. What is corner frequency? Tell me, what is corner frequency? Corner frequencies are those frequencies at which the dB gain changes their slope. Okay, the dB gain changes their slope, right? So here we have two corner frequencies. The two corner frequencies are what is the corner frequency? What are the corner frequencies here? 1 by alpha t and 1 by t. Okay, which is greater, alpha t or t? Which one is greater? Which one is greater here? Alpha t or t? Alpha t is greater. Why? Because alpha is greater than 1. Okay, so since alpha t is very much greater than t, okay, since alpha t is very much greater than t, what happens? Which one will be greater? Which frequency will be greater? Omega c1 or omega c2? Omega c2 will be greater than omega c1, or omega c1 will be less than omega c2, right? Omega c1 will be less than omega c2, right? Now, at very low frequencies. So we can say that, I initially in the beginning, I spoke of low frequency and mid frequency region, right? So from low frequency to omega c1 is the low frequency region. Omega c1 to omega c2 is the mid frequency region. And then onwards, high frequency region. You can think in that way. Okay? Up to omega c1, low frequency. Between omega c1 and omega c2, mid frequency region. And afterwards, after omega c2 onwards, high frequency region. You can think in that direction also. Okay? So at very low frequencies, that is up to omega c1. Okay, so what happens? Omega t is very much less than 1, and hence alpha omega t will be also very much less than 1. Say for example, your corner frequency is 0.01. So alpha omega t will be 0.05. It will be 0.05. Okay, so it is very much less than one. So since it is very much less than one, from this expression, from the dBKn expression, you will see it is alpha square omega square t square. So 0.05 square, which is even more smaller, 0.0025. Similarly, in the denominator, you will get 0.0001. Okay, so that means from this expression, alpha square omega square t square can be ignored, and in the denominator, omega square t square can be ignored. Okay, so at very low frequencies, our magnitude GC of G omega will be approximately equal to what? 20 log 1, which is nothing but 0 dB. Okay, so up to least corner frequency omega C1, right? The magnitude is nothing but 0 dB approximately, right? Now, in the mid frequency range, that is omega C1 to omega C2. Okay, in the mid frequency range, what happens? Alpha omega T will be very much greater than 1, but omega T will be very much less than 1. Okay, in the mid frequency range, omega T will be very much less than 1, but alpha omega T will be significantly higher. Okay, so from here you will see that this omega T in the denominator can be ignored, but here you will get 1 plus root of 1 plus alpha square omega square t square. Since alpha omega t is very much greater than 1, alpha square omega square t square will be even more greater. That means this 1 from the numerator can be dropped. So approximately the magnitude will be equal to what? 20 log root of alpha square omega square t square. Or you will get mod GC of G omega as approximately equal to what? 20 log alpha omega t decibels. Okay, so keep in mind, up to least corner frequency omega C1, it is 0 dB. Then from omega C1 to omega C2, it is 20 log alpha omega T. Okay, now at very high frequencies, that is after omega C2. Okay, so at very high frequencies, what happens? Both omega T and alpha omega T will be very much greater than 1. Okay. Omega T will be very much greater than 1, and alpha omega T will also be very much greater than 1. Okay. So from this expression, what happens? Alpha square omega T square will be more prominent in the numerator, and the denominator omega square T square will be prominent. So these ones can be ignored. You will get alpha omega T by omega T, which means alpha. So the magnitude will be approximately equal to about 20 log alpha. Okay, therefore, mod GC of G omega will be approximately equal to 20 log alpha decibels. Okay, 20 log alpha decibels. So keep in mind, what is alpha? Alpha is a quantity greater than 1. Okay, so at very low frequencies, it has a unity gain. 0 dB means what? Unity gain. Okay, so let us plot the body plot for this. So this is frequency in logarithmic scale, and this is the dB gain. Okay, so this is the corner frequency omega C1. This is corner frequency omega C2. Okay. So you see, up to omega C1, what was the magnitude? Magnitude was 0 dB. Okay, so up to the corner frequency omega C1, we have 0 dB gain. 0 dB. Okay, now from omega C1 to omega C2, okay, what's the magnitude plot? It is a straight line with a slope of plus 20 decibels per decade. Okay, plus 20 dB per decade. Okay. Up to what value? Up to the highest corner frequency, omega C2. So this is omega C2. Okay. And then onwards, what happens? It will be another horizontal line with a slope with a magnitude of 20 log alpha decibels. 20 log alpha decibels. So this magnitude is 20 log alpha. Okay, so this is the magnitude plot for a lead compensator. Fine. Now let us try to plot the phase angle plot, right? Now, what is the angle part? angle GC of j omega. What was that? Tan inverse alpha omega t minus tan inverse omega t. Okay. Now, as omega tends to zero, what will be the angle? Angle GC of j omega will also tend to zero, right? Because tan inverse zero minus tan inverse zero. As omega tends to infinity, what happens? Angle GC of j omega will, that will also again tend to 0 degree. Okay, so that means what? That means what? What will, how will be the phase angle plot? This is frequency in logarithmic scale. This is the angle part. Angle GC j omega. Okay, so this was the least corner frequency. This was the upper cutoff frequency or upper corner frequency. Okay, now, so as omega tends to zero and omega tends to infinity, it will be tending to zero, right? So you will see that at some point, this phase angle is maximum. Okay, at some point, the phase angle is maximum. Okay, it will give a phase lead angle. You can, if you have any doubt, you can take different values of omega and make a point by point and plot it. Okay. So at some point, this phase angle, the phase lead contributed by the lead composite will be a maximum. Let me call that as phi m. That's the maximum phase angle that can be contributed. Okay. There's a maximum phase angle, phase lead angle that can be contributed by a lead compensator. And that happens at a particular frequency. Let that frequency be omega m. Okay, what is phi m? What is phi or the phase angle? That is the phase angle contributed by the lead compensator. At some particular frequency omega m, the phase angle contribution becomes the peak, the maximum. That angle is phi m, I am indicating. Okay, and as frequency increases, what happens? It will start coming down, it will be dropping down, and eventually it will tend to zero as omega tends to infinity. Okay, so this is the, as you can see here, the compensator provides a positive angle, a leading angle. That's why it is called a phase lead compensator. Fine. Now let us try to find an expression for these things. So you see what happens? High frequency noise signals will be amplified here. Okay. Ideally speaking, noise signals should not be amplified, right? Ideally, we want a boost in the phase at and about the gain cross of frequency. That's what we want. Okay, but here, since alpha is greater than one, the noise signals or the high frequency signals will be amplified. Okay, whereas the low frequency signals will pass through unit amplification. Okay. Now we have to find what is phi m and what is omega m. So let us try to find that expression. Okay, to find omega m, the frequency at which phi m occurs. At which maximum phase lead phi m occurs. Okay. Now, what is the angle, this thing, angle GC of j omega? Let me call for convenience that as some phi. Okay. Keep in mind phi and phi m are different. Phi m is the maximum lead angle. Phi is the lead angle, that's it. Okay. So I'm calling angle GC j omega as phi for convenience. Okay. What is that? Tan inverse alpha omega t minus tan inverse omega t. Okay. So at some frequency omega m, it is maximum, right? How will you find the maximum of a function? You have to differentiate that with respect to the variable. Okay. So at omega equal to omega m d by d omega. Okay, of phi must be equal to zero. D by d omega m. D by d omega m at phi must be equal to zero. So that means you have to differentiate that. D by d omega of tan inverse alpha omega t minus tan inverse omega t equal to zero. You have to differentiate that. Okay. How will you differentiate this? What is the derivative d by dx of tan inverse x? What will you get? What is that? It is nothing but 1 divided by 1 plus x square. Okay, 1 divided by 1 plus x square. So if you apply that here, you will get what? 1 divided by 1 plus alpha square omega square t square into alpha t minus 1 by 1 plus omega square t square into 1 into t. Okay, equal to 0. Right? So it of course it is happening at omega m. Okay, so this is d omega m. Equal to 0, right? Now you can solve this. So 1 t and t gets cancelled. So that means alpha by 1 plus alpha square omega m square t square must be equal to 1 divided by 1 plus omega m square t square. Okay, so you solve this, do some simplification, you will get your omega m as 1 divided by t root alpha. Okay, omega m will be 1 divided by t root alpha. Fine, this is the frequency at which the compensator can give the maximum phase leap. Okay, now let me ask you something. What was our pole? Our pole was at compensator pole, we had chosen that to be at 1 by t, right? And our zero was at 1 by alpha t. So what happens if you take the geometric mean of this root pc into zc? What will you get? Root of 1 by t into 1 by alpha t. You will get 1 by t root alpha, same as this thing. So that means the frequency at which maximum phase angle occurs is given by the geometric mean of the pole and zero. Okay, the geometric mean of the pole and zero. Okay, so omega m is equal to 1 by t root alpha. So we can mark this as omega m. Okay, and this as 1 by t root alpha. Now, how much is the maximum phase angle? That's what we have to find. Okay, to find the maximum phase angle. To find the maximum phase leap, phi. Okay, so what is the total angle? Phi. Phi was tan inverse alpha omega t minus tan inverse omega t. Okay, so you can take tangent on both sides. What is tan of a minus b? What is tan of a minus b? Tell me, what is tan of a minus b? Tan a minus tan b by 1 plus tan a tan b. Tan of a minus b will be tan a minus tan b, tan a minus tan b divided by 1 plus tan a tan b. Okay, so we have to apply that here. So what will you get? You will get tan phi equals what? Alpha omega t minus omega t divided by 1 plus alpha omega square t square. Okay, so I can take omega t common, omega t into alpha minus 1 by 1 plus alpha omega t square. Okay, now for max, when does maximum phase lead occur? When does that occur? It occurs at when omega equal to omega I. Okay, so you can just substitute for, instead of omega, you can substitute for omega m as 1 divided by t root alpha. Therefore, tan phi m will be what? Omega m t into alpha minus 1 divided by 1 plus alpha omega m square t square. So just substitute omega m, we know it is 1 by t root alpha. 1 by t root alpha into t into alpha minus 1 whole divided by 1 plus alpha into 1 by t square alpha into t square. Okay? If you simplify this, you should get alpha minus 1 divided by 2 root alpha. Okay, so this is the maximum phase lead angle that can be provided by the lead compensator, right? Now, let us take one more simplification. You consider a right angle triangle with this angle as phi m. What is tan phi m? Opposite side by adjacent side. What will be hypotenuse here? Alpha plus 1. Okay, so I can write in terms of sine also. What will be my sine phi m? Sine phi m will be alpha minus 1 divided by alpha plus 1. Okay, or what will be alpha from this? Alpha will be 1 plus sine phi m divided by 1 minus sine phi m. Okay, so Just for curiosity, let me ask you one thing. What will be the magnitude when omega equal to omega m? What's the magnitude? How can you find that? What's the total magnitude here? 20 log root of 1 plus alpha square omega square t square by root of 1 plus omega square t square. So instead of omega, you substitute 1 by t root alpha. Okay. So what will you get? 20 log root of 1 plus alpha square into 1 by t square alpha into t square divided by root of 1 plus 1 by t square alpha into t square. T square gets cancelled. Alpha and 1 alpha goes. Right? Did I make a mistake here? T square gets cancelled. This is 1 plus alpha. So what will you get? 20 log root of 1 plus alpha, correct, divided by root of 1 plus alpha into root alpha. So you will get 20 log root alpha dB. Okay. So when the frequency is corresponding to the maximum phase angle lead, what will be the magnitude of the corresponding this thing? The magnitude will be 20 log root alpha. Okay. Magnitude will be 20 log root alpha. Okay. So we can see that the approximate magnitude plot of the lead compensator is a straight line at 0 dB up to the lower corner frequency omega C1. Then it has a slope of plus 20 dB per decade. What's the slope here? Plus 20 decibels per decade. Okay, up to the corner frequency omega C2, and then onwards it will be a straight line at a constant value of 20 log alpha decibels. Similarly, the angle part, as omega is varied from 0 to infinity, what happens? The phase angle increases gradually, reaches a peak, and then decreases back to 0. Okay. So here, as I said before, since alpha is greater than 1, you cannot go for a large value of alpha. What happens? The noise signals will also get amplified. Okay. So you have to judiciously use the value of alpha. Right. Now, let us see how to design a lead compensator with the help of this Bode plot. Okay, so lead compensator design procedure. Okay. One. I will first write down the steps and then I will explain. Set the gain K of the uncompensated system. Set the gain K of the uncompensated system to that value. That satisfies the steady state error requirement. Okay. Two, plot the Bode plot. Plot the Bode plot for this value of K and determine the uncompensated phase margin, uncompensated system phase margin. I will call that phase margin as gamma. Okay, just for ease, I will notate that as gamma. Okay, so what we have to do first, so we'll be given some conditions. My system should have this much steady state error error accuracy. It must have this much of phase margin. It must have this much of phase margin and so on. So first step is we have to find the value of gain K, which means the given steady state error requirement. Okay, Then with that gain into the system, you plot the border plot and check how much is the uncompensated phase margin. Okay. Three. Allowing for a small additional phase angle. Of 5 to 10 degrees, approximately. Determine the necessary additional phase lead. From the compensator. Okay, from the required from the compensator. What's the purpose of compensator? To enhance the phase margin. How? So the phase margin will add from its hand some positive phase lead to the system so that the total compensated system will have the desired phase margin. Okay, then. So I can write like this. Phi m will be what? The desired gamma. Okay, you will be asked that design the compensator so that the compensator system has this much of phase margin. That is gamma d, the desired phase margin. Okay, then how much is the deficiency? We know uncompensated system has gamma, right? So this deficiency plus some 5 to 10 degrees extra. Okay, so it is always like this. Always you can preferably add 10 degrees. Okay. Even though there are no hard and fast rules, how much should it be? Should it be 5 degrees? Should it be 10 degrees? 6 degrees? 7 degrees? That's the designer's choice. Okay. So once we have done all these things and designed the compensator, we will simulate the system with the compensator. Okay. To see whether the given specifications are met. If not, you have to again alter your 5 to 10 degree angle, that additional angle appropriately. Okay. So that's the third step. Then determine alpha. So once we know phi m, we know how to find alpha. How? Because alpha is given by this expression. Alpha is 1 plus sine phi m by 1 minus sine phi m. Okay. So once we know phi m, determine alpha using alpha equals 1 plus sine phi m divided by 1 minus sine phi m. Okay, now determine the compensator magnitude at phi m as. So what's the compensator magnitude at phi m? We have already found that it is nothing but 20 log root alpha. Okay. Once we know this thing, once we know alpha, we can find what's this magnitude, 20 log root alpha. Okay. So we have found what is alpha, and now we can find what's the magnitude as mod GC of J omega m as 20 log root alpha. Okay. So what does the compensator do? The compensator will shift the phase angle, will shift the phase angle of the system in the positive side. Okay, that's what it's going to do, right? That's the purpose of a lead compensator. It has to boost the phase angle around the gain loss of frequency. Okay, and it should not affect the low frequency gain. That's the basic purpose. Okay, to be sure. So 20 log root alpha, right? Now, since the lead compensator provides a gain of 20 log root alpha decibels at omega m, we choose this as the new gain loss of frequency. Okay, this will be the new gain crossover frequency. Okay, this will be the new gain crossover frequency. So just for a comparison, so see some system body mantle plot is given. Okay, so it has this omega GC, omega GC one. Okay, now what happens? So phase margin is found at gain crossover frequency. Okay, so say some sample, this thing is coming here, right? So this is minus 180 degree line. Some random example. Okay, so this much will be the phase margin initially, right? Now what happens? You are pushing the gain crossover frequency to the higher side, right? By adding, right? So when you add a lead compensator, what happens? The phase plot will get shifted up. Okay, now the phase plot may be somewhere here. Okay, so that means the corresponding gain crossover frequency, when you want to find the phase margin, the corresponding omega GC will be somewhere here. It will get shifted. Okay, what does the lead compensator do? The lead compensator will shifts up the phase plot. Okay, so naturally the phase margin will change, right? So corresponding to the new gain crossover frequency omega GC2, you should get a new amount of phase margin here. Are you following me or not? Lead compensator, what it does, it will just shift the phase curve towards the positive side. It will shift the phase curve upwards. Okay, so that means the gain crossover frequency will change now. Okay, so if the gain crossover frequency is to be, suppose the new gain crossover frequency is omega GC2. If omega GC2 is to be the new gain crossover frequency, at that frequency, now it should be 0 dB. Okay, this should be 0 dB, something like that. Then only it can be called gain crossover frequency. Okay, so what we do here is that the new gain crossover frequency omega m. Okay, so we are forcing omega m to be the new gain crossover frequency. Okay, so that means the original uncompensated system magnitude plot must be shifted up from minus 20 log root alpha, so that now once it is compensated, it becomes equal to 0 dB. Are you following me what I'm saying? Compensator at omega m can provide a magnitude, a gain of 20 log root alpha. Okay, now what is omega m? Omega m was the frequency at which the compensator provided the maximum phase lead. Okay, now we want to have omega m as our gain crossover frequency. Okay, so originally, keep in mind, we had uncompensated this plot, body mantle plot. Now we are going to introduce a lead compensator, okay, which can provide a maximum phase lead of phi m at the frequency omega m, right? So the original uncompensated plot had omega g1 as the gain crossover frequency, right? Now we want to have the compensator system to have the gain crossover frequency at omega m. That means there will be a change in gain crossover frequency. Okay, so the magnitude plot will be moved up slightly. Okay, in the mid frequency region I'm speaking of, not in the low frequency region. Okay, so the magnitude plot will be moved up. Okay, so that now omega m will be made the gain crossover frequency. Okay, so that's what we are writing here. Since the lead compensator provides a gain of 20 log root alpha decibels at omega m, this will be the new gain crossover frequency. Determine, how can we determine this frequency now? Determine omega m where the uncompensated magnitude curve equals minus 20 log root alpha. Okay, so the uncompensated curve is now shifted up by a value of 20 log root alpha, so that omega m is the new gain crossover frequency of the compensated system. Okay, that is how we can find omega m, right? Now, once you know omega, m, and alpha, it is just a matter of simple calculation. Calculate compensator pole. Calculate the compensator pole. What will be PC, compensator pole PC? It will be nothing but omega m into root alpha. And how will you find compensator zero? It will be PC divided by alpha. Okay. So last step, draw the compensator pole plot. Draw the compensated body plot and check the resulting phase margin and repeat the steps if necessary. And repeat the steps if necessary. Okay, let's take one numerical example now, then it will be clear. A unity feedback system has a unity feedback system with g of s equals k divided by s into s plus 2. Okay, you have to design a lead compensator so that the following specifications are met. Okay, steady state error for a ramp input equals 5% of velocity of ramp to phase margin must be at least 45 degrees. Okay. Phase margin must be at least 45 degrees. Okay, so we are given g of s equals k divided by s into s plus 2. Right? What's the first step? Set the gain k. Okay, set the gain k of the uncompensated system so that steady state error requirement is met. Okay, what's the steady state error requirement given here? Steady state error for a ramp input must be equal to 0.05. Okay, so we are given steady state error must be equal to what? 5% means 0.05 for a ramp input. And what is steady state error for a ramp input? How will you find that? 1 divided by KV must be equal to 0.05, or KV must be equal to what? 20. Okay. And what is KV? Nothing but limit S tends to 0, S G of S. Right? So substitute that limit S tends to 0, S into K divided by S into S plus 2. S and S gets cancelled, you will get K by 2. Okay, from which k equal to 40. Okay, so that's the first step. But set the gain k so that it satisfies steady state requirement. So what is our g of s now? Our g of s is nothing but 40 divided by s into s plus 2. Right, now what next? Plot the border plot for this value of gain k and determine the uncompensated system phase margin. Okay, so now we have to plot the border plot. Since this transformation is a simple one, we can do a hand calculation instead of doing a plot. If you want, you can also do it with the plot, either by hand plot or by a MATLAB simulation plot also. Okay. So how to find it by calculation? So we have to find phase margin. Phase margin is found at gain cross of frequency. What is gain cross of frequency? Frequency at which the gain is equal to 1. Okay. So GJ omega will be what? 40 divided by J omega into J omega plus 2. What's the magnitude? 40 divided by omega into root of omega square plus 4. Okay. So how will you, what is gain cross of frequency? Frequency at which omega magnitude is equal to 1. Therefore, 1 must be equal to what? 40 divided by omega GC into root of omega GC square plus 4. From which your omega GC, you will get that as 6.1684 radians per second. Okay, 6.1684 radians per second. That is your omega GC. Now, how will you find phase margin? Phase margin is 180 plus angle GJ omega GC. What's the angle GJ omega GC here? Angle GJ omega will be what from this? Minus 90, minus tan inverse omega by 2. Okay, so you can substitute that here, and you will see that the uncompensated phase margin gamma will turn out to be 17.96 degree. Okay, at omega g is equal to 6.1684 radians per second. Okay, that was our second step, right? Plot the body plot and determine the uncompensated phase margin, right? Now what we have to do, we have to find what is, how much angle can, should be provided by the lead compensator. Okay, therefore phi m, what is phi m? The desired phase margin, how much is that? At least 45 degree, at least 45 degree. So the desired phase margin is 45 degree minus the uncompensated phase margin is 17.96 plus some extra angle for compensation angle. That means 10 degree. Okay, so that turns out to be 37.04. So the lead compensator that we are going to design should give a maximum phase lead of 37.04 degrees, right? So once we know phi m, we can find alpha. How? Alpha will be 1 plus sine phi m divided by 1 minus sine phi m. Keep in mind, what is alpha? Alpha is the ratio of the compensator pole to zero. Okay, so if you substitute this phi m here and solve for alpha, you will get alpha as 4.0298. Okay, so we determined alpha. What next? We have determined what is the compensator magnitude at phi m. What is that? 20 log root alpha. Okay, so now we have to find what is the magnitude of the gain provided by the compensator at omega m. That is nothing but 20 log root alpha. How much is that? Substitute it, you will get 20 log root alpha as 6.0528 decibels. Okay, so you should see in your mind, in the background. So the compensator will provide this much gain. Okay, by pulling the at the same time, it will also pull the uncompensated phase plot to the positive side, to the upper side. Okay, so now what happened? What next? So the uncompensated system, we have to find omega m by calculating this value minus 20 log root alpha. Okay, so how to find omega m? Omega m can be found by equating, by taking the negative of this and equating it to the magnitude. What will be the magnitude? 20 log 40 by omega m into root of omega m square plus 4. Okay, you can just simplify this and you will see that your omega m will be around 8.8504 radians per second. Okay, originally it was 6.1684, now it is 8.8504. okay, so originally the uncompensated system had a phase margin, had a gain cross of frequency somewhere, maybe here. This was omega GC1. Okay, now what happens? You are adding the phase angle. You are adding a phase angle to the uncompensated system, right? So that means now it will be somewhere, it will be something like this. Something like this. So that you will get a new gain cross of frequency, omega GC2. Okay, so with the compensator, this was without compensator. This is with the compensator. Where did we mark a different color? Some rough shape only I am drawing. Okay, this is with compensator. With compensator. And this was without compensator. Okay, so now omega m is the new gain cross of frequency. Right? Once you know omega m, you know alpha. What will be the compensator pole? Compensator pole will be omega m root alpha. Just substitute this value, you should get 17.7666. And how can you find compensator zero? PC by alpha. You will get 4.4088. Okay, 4.4088. Now it's a matter of just substitution. What was our compensator transfer function? Our compensator transfer function was this. Okay, it's just a matter of substitution. So PC by ZC is alpha. Alpha into S plus ZC by S plus PC. Alpha you know, ZC we know, PC we found. Okay, so what will be the compensator transfer function? Therefore, GC of S will be alpha times S plus ZC divided by S plus PC. So that becomes 4.0298 into S plus 4.4088 divided by S plus 17.7666. Okay, so what will be the compensated open loop transfer function now? Therefore, compensated open loop transfer function. Keep in mind, initially we had a figure like this. This was our plant. Okay, so we were asked to design a lead compensator so that certain given specifications are also to be satisfied. So now we have our compensator here. This is GC of S compensator. Here we have our plant G of S. Okay, so compensated open loop transfer function means this thing, because H of S is one here. Okay, so that will be nothing but GC of S into G of S. So it will be 4.0298. Why 4.0298 is appearing here? So that this compensator will have a unity DC gain. Okay, otherwise if this factor was missing, if this gain was missing, the compensator itself would have provided some gain. Okay, so to force the compensator to give unity gain at low frequencies, we are having this gain, extra gain of 4.0298. okay, so 4.0298 into what? Into S plus 4.4088 divided by S plus 17.7666 into what? What is our plant? 40 divided by S into S plus 2. Okay, okay, fine. The MATLAB plot is shown here now. Okay, so you can see here there are three graphs, one blue, one is in red, and one is in black color, right? The blue one is the uncompensated system. That means 40 divided by the blue one. Okay, the blue one is 40 divided by S into S plus 2. We had compensated only for the steady state requirement. Okay, this is the compensator. The red one is the compensator only. Okay, this is for the compensator alone. Compensator alone, and the black one is the compensated system. Compensated system. Okay, this is the uncompensated one. Right. So we can see here, cross check here. As per our initial calculation, we had a gain cost of frequency of 6.1684. So you see from the blue curve, blue one is the uncompensated thing. It is omega GC was 6.17. Right. And the phase margin was about 18 degree. We got 7.96, right? And once we inserted the compensator into the system, the compensator system has a gain cost of frequency of 8.85. As per our calculation, we had 8.8504. That was the frequency at which the phase lead was maximum by the compensator. Okay, so now you see what's the phase margin. It is 49.8. What was the specification? Phase margin must be at least 45 degree. So there are no upper bounds spelled out for the phase margin. So we have satisfied the given requirements. Okay, so ideally speaking, so this is how to solve a lead compensator using Bode plot. Okay, so ideally speaking, a lead compensator will, so you can see here what happens. This was the phase plot initially, right? So it has been pulled up. The blue curve, the bottom half has been pulled up, has been modified to the black one. Okay, so the phase, the lead compensator will insert a will what will, what it does, if a lead compensator will give a phase boost about the gain cost of frequency. Okay, you can see here the low frequency in the top plot, the low frequency magnitude is unaltered. It has not been touched. Okay, both the black and the blue are coinciding, right? So that's the purpose of a lead compensator. Without disturbing the steady state performance, we have to modify the transient behavior. So now what's the phase margin? Now the phase margin is 49.8 degrees. What was the original phase margin? It was around 18 degrees. Okay, so phase margin has been increased. The gain cost of frequency has also been changed from 6.17 to 8.85. The gain margin remains unchanged, and we have met the steady state error requirement. This is how to design the lead compensator using Bode plot. Okay. So in a nutshell, we had tried to understand what is a lead compensator, how to design the lead compensator using Bode plot. Okay. So ideally speaking, a lead compensator should give a phase boost around omega GC, the gain plus the frequency. Okay. Without changing the low frequency gain. Right. So we had taken up one numerical example. I would urge you all to try some more examples so that you can have your own confidence. If you have any doubt, get back to me. So we'll stop here for the time being. Thank you.